So in this case, we'll look at what's a diagonally dominant matrix. So n by n matrix A, so it's a square matrix, is diagonally dominant. If what happens is that each of the elements which are in the diagonal, the absolute value of that will be greater than the sum of the absolute elements of the rest of the elements which are in that row. So we'll explain it through an example, and also we'll go through this formula again. So we have summation here, j is equal to 1 to n, I naught equal to j, absolute value of a I comma j, I is equal to 1 through n, and then this is greater than or equal to, and then we say a I has to be strictly greater than this summation which we just wrote, j is equal to 1 to n, I naught equal to j, a I j, for at least 1 I. So let's concentrate on this part here. So what this means is that you have the diagonal element, you take the absolute value of that, then you look at the row I, and you take the sum of the absolute absolute value of all the elements in that row except for AII, that's why it's I not equal to J, and you add all of them up and you find out if the diagonal element is greater than or equal to that sum. Now we're saying greater than or equal to, which, and then here we're saying greater than, so for at least one of the values of I, it can be 1, 2, 3, n, any of the values of I, for at least one row, that's what we mean by at least one I, so for at least one row, this particular inequality has to be strictly greater than. That's when we'll consider a matrix to be diagonally dominant. So let's look at an example and see that whether a particular matrix is diagonally dominant or not. So what we're going to do is we're going to take several examples and to make sure that that's the case. So let's look at this particular matrix here and see that whether we can classify it as a diagonally dominant matrix. So 15, 6, 7, 2, minus 4, minus 2, 3, 2, 6. So here what you're finding out is that let's look at row number 1. So when I is equal to 1, row number 1, the absolute value of the diagonal element is 15. You're finding out right here. So absolute value of A11 is equal to 15. Let's see what the sum of the rest of the elements is, which is A12 plus A13. The absolute value of the rest of the elements in that row will be the absolute value of A12 and absolute A13. We're going to add those up. And what do we get? We get absolute value of 6 plus absolute value of 7. That is 13. So it is greater than or equal to. Let's go for I is equal to 2. So when you say I is equal to 2, the second row, second column, absolute value is absolute value of minus 4, which is 4. Let's see whether it's greater than or equal to the rest of the elements being added together, their absolute values. So we have A21, which is right here, absolute value of that, plus the absolute value of A23, which is right there, A23. These are the rest of the elements in the A matrix right there. So this one will be A21 is 2, so it's absolute value of 2. A23 is minus 2, so that gives me 4, and 4 is greater than or equal to 4, so that inequality is satisfied. Let's go for I is equal to 3. Let's go to the third row, third column. That number is 6. Absolute value of 6 will be 6. Let's see whether it's greater than or equal to the sum of the absolute value of the elements which are left over. So is it greater than or equal to A third row first column absolute value, which is this one, plus A third row second column, which is right this one here, absolute value of 3 plus absolute value of 2, and that gives me 5, and 6 is greater than or equal to 5. So we have satisfied the inequality which we had for the first condition, that for each row the diagonal element absolute value has to be greater than the sum of the absolute value of the rest of the elements in that particular row. But are we meeting the strictly greater than condition? Yes, we are. We are meeting that condition for the first row, not for the second row, but for the third row. But we need this strictly greater than inequality to be satisfied just for one row. So this particular matrix is diagonally dominant. Let's look at this matrix. Somebody gives us a matrix like this, 25, 5, 1, 64, 8, 1, 144, 12, 1. And somebody's saying, hey, can you show that whether this square matrix is diagonally dominant or not? So again, what I'll do is I'll take the absolute value of the first row, first column, which is C11, which is 25 here. And let me look at the rest of the elements of that particular row, which is this element and this element. So that's the absolute value of the first row, second column, plus the absolute value of the first row, third column, which is 5, absolute value plus absolute value of 1, which is 6, and surely this is greater than or equal to. Let's look at the second row. So this is I equal to 1. That's what we talk about, I equal to 1. Let's look at I equal to 2. Now, I equal to 2 will have second row, second column, which is this one here, right here, which is absolute value of 8, is 8. Let's see whether this is 8 is greater than the sum of the absolute elements of the rest of the sum of the absolute elements of the rest of the row here. So that'll be C21, second row, first column, and then left is second row, third column, which is absolute value of 64 plus absolute value of 1, which is 65. Is that greater than or equal to 65? 8 greater than 65? No. So C automatically is not diagonally dominant. I don't need to look at the third row because it already has violated the inequality for the second row. So it is not diagonally dominant. And that's the end of this segment.